Hotech. Hotech.
Okay, so before the rump session starts, a short announcement about the dinner tomorrow. So as said, the buses will leave for 6 o'clock from Schwedenplatz, which you have it explained in your back where this is and on the webpage. And then there will be buses going back from the Heurigen starting from 9:30 regularly till midnight. So you can choose whenever you want to go back. As soon as the bus is full or so, we go just back. Okay, so there will be travel provided to get back home to Vienna.
Hotech?
And something else, please do, so we had to promise the venue here that people will not sit, be seated with drinks. And the reason is the floor is very delicate, and if you spill something on the floor, it has to be cleaned immediately, and when people sit, then they will throw them over. So we promised them no drinks beyond this line, so please stick to it. And if you spill something, please let someone, one of us know immediately so we can clean it up. It's like white marble stuff or something, and it soaks in red wine especially.
Hotech, where are you? Hello? In principle, we could start, so I would like to ask you to take a seat. Can we just start, please? So, welcome to the RAM session of this Eurocrypt. I was waiting for my co-chair, apparently he got lost. There he is, come on. Big applause to Hotech. It's a wonderful co-chair. So, no, you just stay here. So this RAM session is for some reason dedicated to Donald Trump because he wants to make cryptography great again. Unfortunately for this evening, there's not a program on the website yet, so we're working on that to put this online. However, the list of speakers is on this slide. So this is what we will have, is a break in the middle and two sessions. So one before the break, one after the break. And this is the speakers of the first session. So it goes that down and then on that side. So I give you a minute to find, if you submitted a paper, to find your name on that list. I will also, you will get a hint right in advance before you are going to speak. All right, then the first speaker would be Mark Fischlin. Is he around? Or is this the second guy that got lost? So always on these slides, on these title slides, you will find, if you're a speaker, your name eventually there on the bottom corner. So get ready, you will be the next one to speak if you find your name there.
All right, thanks. First I should thank Bertram and Hurtok for running the RAM session. I was lucky, I asked them last year when they were a little bit drunk, and I told them that they actually accepted. All right, so it's a good tradition to give a small report about the running of the program committee and so on. I would like to focus on one thing only, and this is the number of submissions. So these are the number of submissions to Eurocrypt. So you see in the past years, it has been pretty stable at around 200. And this year, you see, we went up to 274. And this may be correlated to the fact that we now announced to have parallel tracks. And you may wonder why, if we started in 2015, why this didn't affect the number of submissions back then. And the reason was that submission is usually half a year earlier, and that was before we even thought about having parallel tracks. Now, you may wonder, how this is going to continue? Will we have an even further increase in number of submissions? The good news, and this is something I would like to tell you, is we're actually getting help from the outside to keep the number of submissions low. Okay, do you understand what I mean? Here's what typically happens. You are an author, you submit your paper. If your paper is good and you're lucky, the program committee accepts the paper, and then your name and the title of your paper appears on the list of accepted papers on the web page. So this year we accepted, or it was clear that we'll accept around 60 papers by having the parallel tracks, and for some reason this incites people to submit more papers. But in crypto we always have the adversary, and the adversary in our setting actually try to attack the authors. And this is no joke. Apparently there was a company which, after a list of accepted papers, including the authors, were out, went through this list, looked up the authors, looked up their contact address, and called them on the phone, telling them they are responsible for hotel service, and of course they need the credit card number. Several authors have confirmed that this actually happened. And then, if you look it up on the web, actually that seems to be a new kind of phishing attack, which happens all the time. So we're not the only conference which gets under this attack. For example, here's a company which seems to be EHM, which seems to be frequently cited in this context. And since this is the Trump session, actually, and I saw this trustworthy businessman here, I can just make him a Trump. It has nothing to do with the actual content of this presentation. So, and actually they're quite good. They provide all the details, like the dates of the conference, I think even the chair's name if necessary. They have a homepage. So this is this company. I'm not actually sure if this is the company which ran the attack for Eurocrypt, but they have a homepage and you see the employees are happy and successful people. But it's obvious if you look closer that there's something wrong with their business. I still need to work on that, I think. Okay, we caught this quite early and we sent out email to the author, so I don't think much damage was actually done in this case. But back to the more serious stuff, why does this help us, in what sense? So if you think about it, these companies will not stop doing this. I mean, that's their business model. So you cannot expect that this goes away. It's unlikely that if you have a paper accepted that we will not announce your author name on the list of accepted papers. Otherwise, you would have to register for a conference without knowing what the talks are. If you submit a good paper, it should get in. So there's nothing you can do about this. The only thing which saves you from getting under phishing attacks is not submitting papers, actually. Okay, so think about this, and it will actually help future chairs. Okay, just this is my last slide. I already get the waving from the rump station chairs. This is a little bit more serious. If you think about how things develop, it's actually worthwhile to look at the acceptance rates. So you see it has been stable around 20%, and maybe we're going back there slowly, and now you can do the math. Typically, if you have two parallel tracks, you can host up to 60, slightly more than 60 papers. And if we reach the 20% again, this means the future chairs will have to cope with around 310 submissions. And in this sense, my conclusion is, boy, I'm quite happy I've done my turn now. All right, thanks.
Hello, everyone. I'm at Tekin Kupchu from Koch University. So let's assume a hypothetical scenario where we have Bernie, Hillary, Raccoon, Mozart, and Trump's going to enter an election. So they each have done their voter research. If they say about, if they talk about some topic or do something, then they are going to gain that much voters, let's say. So now they want to optimize their strategies, but they don't want to reveal their individual research outputs. So what are they going to do? They are going to run a secure multi-party computation protocol such that they each get their optimal strategies as output. Of course, the problem is, in general, without honest majority, secure multi-party computation is not fair. So it's possible that one of the parties obtain the output, whereas the others don't, which may lead to, actually, this arrow should have been the bottom, which may lead to catastrophic outcomes. So how do we prove secure multi-party computation secure? We have an ideal world with a trusted party. Parties send their inputs, they get their outputs back. And in the real world, we have adversary controlling some of the parties, let's say up to n minus one parties, and then they run this protocol, and we need a simulator that simulates this adversary in the ideal world. As I said, it's impossible without honest majority, so we need a trusted third party called the arbiter. I will skip these for now, but I want to ensure that the ideal trusted party is an ideal entity that doesn't exist. The arbiter is a real entity that exists as a trusted party in the real world. So what we show is, first of all, these interactions with the real trusted party, the arbiter, must be simulated. Most of the previous works, what they do is they prove via ideal real simulation that the protocol is secure with aborts, and then they argue that the additional messages will cause fairness. This is problematic. We need to simulate the whole protocol without any aborts in the ideal world. And indeed, we show that otherwise, if you do the first option simulation and then separate the fairness argument, the protocol may be insecure. We also need to ensure in our simulation that we contact the ideal trusted party only when the fairness is guaranteed. So why? Because let's say our simulator sends the inputs to the ideal party. All the ideal parties will obtain their outputs. But in reality, the adversary may choose to abort the protocol. So while the RDL parties obtained their outputs, the real parties didn't obtain any outputs. Is it zero or one? Okay, so skipping, we have optimal asymptotic performance that works for cut and choose and zero knowledge protocols in malicious and covert settings for two-party and multi-party protocol. Thank you.
One, two.
Let me introduce to you our mascot, the raccoon.
Okay, so my name is Roberto, and I will be fired after this talk. So when we think about lightweight primitives for memory encryption, of course, our first thought goes to Prince, the son of Enigma, one of a shiny example of German technology that has been inspired by Austrian leadership. And where does this inspiration comes? Well, from Mozart, of course, because Prince, as we know, has the structure of a Mozart testicle. It's an involuntary core with several, which is surrounded by symmetric layers, wrapped in a thin but opaque kind of brown shirt, which we call the whitening. And it's a really nice cipher. But as everything in the world, there are situations where we cannot use it as it is. So let's move from Austria to the second most dangerous country in the world, which is the States. So Suppose you want to do memory encryption, but you cannot do any memory overhead. So you want to use the cipher in SCB mode. Well, the problem is that you still have traces of Herr Dumpf after electronic code book encryption. So another idea could be, well, let's use a Rogaway XEX mode, but you have additional latency in order to derive, in a secure way, the whitening value for each address. So the idea is, oh, it would be nice if there were a tweakable version of Prince. Well, it turns out it's difficult to do it, but after talking to friends in Haifa, then in Bochum, then again in Haifa, I came up with this design. The lightweight tweakable block cipher Karma is a three-round even Mansura scheme where the permutations are keyed and two are also tweaked, and it's not strictly involutory in the middle. And the whitening key derivation uses an automorphism. So it looks like any other bricklayer substitution permutation network, but you see there is an additional rail on the outside, which is a simple tweak schedule. But the important thing here is what happens in the middle that changes the FX construction into something different. So let's have a closer look at these. In order to make attacks like reflection attacks and a lot of other types of cryptanalysis, we use the whitening keys in the middle instead of the core key. That makes finding a characteristic after the XOR impossible. Also, the pseudo-reflector in the middle is not invertible, but it can easily be inverted. And the matrices are quite nice, are a new type of almost MDS matrices. And in the paper, you will see the rationale. And there is also a bit of mathematics. 1 minute, OK. So of course, we want to see the proof in the pudding. And the question is, how efficient is it? Well, Karma has best-in-class latency in the 64-bit version. So it offers quite a nice security bounds. But it is not slower than the competition. There is also a 128-bit version, which is quite nice, because for the claimed security level, which I invite you to challenge, it can offer, for instance, one third of the latency of AES in half of the area. Good news, Karma is in the public domain. We did not patent it, and we made sure we did not use other people's IP there, to the best of our knowledge. So have fun.
Right, hello. Right, can you hear me at the back? Good. Right, so all the speakers have to shout, otherwise everyone at the back chats, because at the back we can't hear anybody. Right, okay. So there is a long tradition at Rump Sessions or at Eurocrypts or whatever, in that the long tradition is we have some jobs. That's it. It's the same bloody thing every time. We have some jobs, right? That's it. And they're 5 years. So if you have anyone who's vaguely qualified, warm body, breathing, yeah, knows a bit about whatever, we have some jobs. Next one.
Thank you, Nigel, for making everybody pay attention. Who went to the membership meeting before? So you heard all this already. Christian scooped me. I'll just give you a few more details and updates. So a new publication model for FSE. We're switching to the ICR transactions on symmetric cryptology with the cool acronym TOSC. So we're going to publish a conference Dromel hybrid in gold open access. There'll be 4 submission deadlines per year. The review process will take 8 weeks, which is faster than any other conference and way faster than most journals. The reviews will not be done by sub-reviews or sub-sub-reviews, but by the editorial board members themselves. This is a big difference, I think, also from many conferences. There will be a rebuttal phase and then a revised final version. There is 5 possible decisions: accept with minor revision and shepherding, accept with major revision, then you come back within the next two rounds, so you submit after a month or after 4 months, reject or strong reject. So our target for the average paper is 3.5 months from submission to publication in the journal, which is faster than any conference of the ICR. What are the goals? Better quality submission. You don't have to rush for the deadline. There is no deadline in 3 months. So we don't want half-baked papers. We don't want papers full of typos. If you can't fix it, come back in 3 months. As I mentioned, faster turnaround. Hopefully better reviews, which are to some extent sticky, although we may also assign new people if we think issues are contentious. There will be one version of your paper available from day one, nothing with 2 years and 4 years and 3 years, and it's just one gold version of the paper. The cost is zero, and we hope to get an ISI impact factor in 3 years, which is very important for researchers in Europe and in Asia. Next deadline is pretty soon, June 1st. So start writing today or tomorrow. There is a new format, which is, you can find it on the ICR website. Thanks to Gaetan Laurent for providing this. It is slightly more printer friendly than LNCS. And please don't hack it. I've seen in my life so many LNCS hacks, which annoy Springer. Now, if you will hack the format, you will annoy the ICR and your associate board and the steering committee and so on. So please don't hack the format. Just use plain LaTeX with this style file. Some other new things, which Christian didn't mention, we have also SOC papers. Systematization of knowledge, where you can write overviews of things. This is something we copied from security and privacy, and I think CCS also has this. We believe it's very valuable. And then the page limit is 20 pages, but there is more on a page than there is in LNCS page. So it's about 22, 23 pages, plus references, and also maybe source code and test values if you have those. If you happen to write longer papers because they have proofs, you can actually go for a 40-page paper, but then we don't guarantee review in 8 weeks. Then you may have to wait another round. Of course, you can always try to bribe Maria and myself in some way to still get the fast treatment, or can try to bribe the reviewers, but on average, I think for long papers, you'll need more time. And as mentioned before, it's a hybrid between a conference and a journal, so you are expected to present your paper at FSE, which will be in Tokyo next year. And general chairs are Shio Moriai and Tetsu Iwata. If you want more details, here are the links. Thank you very much for your attention. Have a nice RAM session.
Hello. So this is about a contest, so listen to it. So maybe you can get some money. So this is some work with my colleagues and also with Monsoon, who is over here, Barry, and also Domingo and Jaime. Well, we want systems that can work in practice, so energy efficiency, small messages, secure, quantum secure. So we have been working on it. We came up with a scheme that we believe that is very efficient, collision resistant, it's a key prestation scheme. So basically, any pair of parties can directly share a key based on identities. We have been working on this for some time. Last year, we started a contest. We announced during a NIST workshop on post-quantum. We got results. They are online on this paper. Quite a lot of people downloaded the challenges, work on it. Now, we have updated some parameters. Oops, here. And you can join the contest. And to join the contest is very simple. You have to go to that website. And, well, there are five challenges. Five challenges, you can get some money per challenge if you manage to break it. And you have some security parameters there for HIMO. That doesn't tell you much. If you have, all the attacks are based on lattices, so if you have alpha 700, you can do it with LLL. For 2000, we estimate the mid factor, that one over there. For the second one, that would be 1.005. For before that was much smaller. So we believe that the parameters are very conservative and still are extremely fast. If you want to know more details, then just come on Friday. And thank you for your attention.
So, hello, I'm Shashank Singh. I'm going to show one of my work, tower number field sieve variant for the recent of the recent polynomial selection algorithm. This is a joint work with Palos Sarkar. So there is a beautiful idea in the last year, AsiaCrypt paper, that using tower number field sieve variant, we can leverage the complexity of large prime case, a large prime field to the medium prime field. We have just used our polynomial selection algorithm to that idea. In fact, the same idea was given by the Kim and Barbescu in the recent ePrint paper, but they only consider it for the conjugation method. So we consider to our recent paper, which I presented in the morning. So this paper is the content of this tower number field sieve variant. Here we have used the new polynomial selection algorithm presented in EuroCrypt 2016. So this gives some, this is the algorithm. I am not going into the detail of the algorithm, but let's see the example. Example, here we can use the tower number field sieve, and we get this kind of complexity there. So this complexity, in fact, subsumes the complexity given by the team and Barbalescu paper. So this is the plot. So in this plot, this dotted line represents the complexity of this Kim and Barbalescu paper, and this shaded area is the place where we have the new complexity result. So in fact, I think they have missed that our polynomial selection algorithm only applies to the composite extension degree, though this is not correct. It applies to the prime degree extension as well. So if we consider, then we have this new complexity trade-off. And this is the combined plot for this multiple number field sieve variant and the classical number field sieve for the tower field number field sieve algorithm. So this is all. Thank you.
So, hello, I'm Serge Vaudenay. I didn't read the instructions, okay. So the session chair says that if we talk about Mozart, we have extra time. Unfortunately, I won't talk about Mozart, I will talk about Wagner. So, let's consider the problem that you have a list of bit strings and you have to find four tuples which sort to zero. So there are essentially two algorithms that we can use. The first one, let's call it the Mozart algorithm. So if you make pairs of bit strings and you compute the XOR and then you look at collision on the XOR, you get an algorithm which has a given time complexity, which is on the bottom, and a data complexity, which is optimal. So the data complexity is optimal, but the time complexity is not so good. There is a better algorithm, which is the Wagner algorithm, which can compute four tuples of strings with XOR zero, except that it adds some constraints on the solution, so you need a higher data complexity and you have a lower time complexity. So yesterday, there was a presentation by Zhang, Chiao, and Wang about faster algorithm for solving LPN, and their method were using the Wagner algorithm. Unfortunately, if you look at the computation, if you look at the computation of the data complexity and the time complexity, for the time complexity, it matches the algorithm of Wagner, but for the data complexity, it matches the algorithm of Mozart. So you have actually two different algorithms, and you cannot use the data complexity of one and the time complexity of the other. So unfortunately, the result, the complexity for this algorithm is not correct. There are some other strange results in this paper. For instance, at some other point in the paper, they have to XOR 10 bytes. So they have to XOR 10 bytes. So if you consider the bit complexity of XORing 10 bytes, you have 80-bit operation. But 80-bit operation for their algorithm, it's too much because they have to repeat it 2 to the 71 times. So instead of multiplying 2 to the 71 by 80, what they do is that they use a huge table where you can just directly read as an address the 10 bytes and look at the result and get the result for free in 1 unit of time. Unfortunately, it's not correct because you still have to consider the time, the complexity of concatenating and the complexity of reading the operations, the complexity of accessing to the table and the complexity of reading. So we corrected, we used some more precise estimate for the time complexity of some algorithms, and we, after correction, the complexity that they claim of 2 to the 74 is corrected to 2 to the 80. So now they may have some other parameters for which lower complexity, but so far they are still above the limit of 2 to the 80. And we also announced our results, which are of 2 to the 78, which have been published on ePrint so far. So I let you with a quote of a famous philosopher, which is here. Thank you very much. Okay, so I can continue to talk. So he's Eric Miles, Amit Sahai.
Hello. So as we've heard, obfuscation is this great tool that can imply a lot of things in crypto. Some would even say it's crypto complete in that it can do anything in crypto. The bad news for us cryptographers is that obfuscation is taking our jobs. As a American political candidate has said, obfuscation is taking our jobs. And this is because, well, now it's making everything so easy. There's nothing left for us to do. So to combat this, we've come up with the Cryptographers Obfuscation Annihilation Patrol. And our mission statement is to make cryptography great again by monitoring developments in obfuscation and generating new technologies to eliminate its threat to cryptographers. We have a two-part program. One is a direct offensive to annihilate the threats of obfuscation. And another one is a covert program where we've inserted double agents to work with the pro-obfuscation people to study obfuscation and leak the developments to us. All right, so how do we attack obfuscation? Well, obfuscation is built from this thing called multilinear maps that sort of protects it, so we need to attack multilinear maps. Fortunately, this has been done to some extent. There's plenty of work showing how to attack multilinear maps. They've weakened the armor, but there's actually been few breaches on actual obfuscation. No one's been able to get through. So we have developed a new class of attacks, annihilation attacks. These are the first successful attacks on obfuscation. We've actually breached multilinear maps and are attacking obfuscation now. And this work will appear in crypto. So we've annihilated several obfuscators in the literature. But the threats are still ongoing. We still don't know how to annihilate obfuscation that uses other multilinear maps or particular obfuscation constructions. And even more worrisome is that obfuscation is becoming annihilation resistant. We've just heard from our spies in the pro-obfuscation community that now we can defend against these attacks. So please join the cause and stop obfuscation to make cryptography great again.
Hello, everyone. My name is Christian Rechberger, and I'm going to announce the winners of the third and final Prince Cipher Breaking Challenge. So, Prince is a cipher that we proposed a few years ago together with a company called NXP. And the idea of this challenge was to incentivize crypto analysts to not only go for the most impractical attack with the highest number of rounds, but go for really practical attacks. And to give some guidance, we did this competition. We have two settings, one in the chosen Prindex setting, where you're given at most 2 to the 20 challenges, and the goal was to find attacks as fast as possible for 4, 6, 8, 10, or the full 12 rounds. And the same for the known plaintext setting. For prizes, we offered Belgian chocolate and beer, and as a request from our esteemed drum session chairs for this opportunity, we changed it to Austrian chocolates, Monsterkugeln. And we even had reserved money for really good attacks, up to 15,000 euros in total. So we had started this competition already in 2014. We had several rounds with several winners. And now it's time to announce the new winners. These were the results before. And there's a number of submissions that were able to beat the currently best results. So on four rounds, we have two winners, one by Harvard Radom and Sharam Rasulsiha, and the other one by Lorenzo Grassi and myself. For six rounds, we have another paper by Harvard and his student having the best attack. And in the chosen plaintext setting, we also have another paper using immediate and middle attack that beats the currently best attacks. And since Howard is here, I would like to give him a box of Monsterkugeln. So please join me in congratulating Howard for his very nice results.
Thank you.
Yeah. Unfortunately, I cannot hand out 15,000 euros. It would have been great. But yeah, that's it. Thank you.
Quick announcement, the program is online now. Next speaker, please. The program of the first session is online now. The program of the second session will follow in 3 minutes.
All right. Are you happy? Are you ready? Woo! I know. This has been at the membership meeting already. But who cares about the membership meeting? So I'm going to make it better. I'm going to make it so much better. And it's going to be so much higher. And the important thing on this slide is you have to know Nobel Prize delay. Anybody knows about Nobel Prize delay? It's the thing that the Nobel Prizes are getting awarded later and later after discoveries. So that means in a few years' time, people just going to get the Nobel Prize because they don't die. So I want to say about the Test of Time Award. Yeah, great idea. I had it too. Woo-hoo. But we should be, there should be an upper limit. And I'm saying 20 years because, you know, RSA, PGP, SSL, DLS, you know, it takes 20 years. So, all right. So, what have you got 20 years ago? Eurocrypt, 1996, Zaragoza, Spain. Great city. Love the city. Yeah, it's amazing. It's great. So, number one, according to Google Scholar, because we know Google Scholar, right? They're good, right? They know their stuff, right? Google knows everything. They're great. They're neutral, objective. Woohoo! So, number one, exact security of digital secrets, how to sign with RSA and Rabin. And that is Mozart. Woohoo! And security proofs for signature screams, Donald J. Trump. And designated verified proofs and their applications by Raccoon, for whatever reason. And me out. Okay, me not out, because next slide. Woohoo! Kudelski security, anyone?
Hello, Eurocrypt. Do you want to earn some money? What? Already over? No. So, I want to remind you about the Norx bug bounty program that's currently running. We have three categories. You can submit bugs for the algorithm. You can submit bugs for security proofs, because everybody loves finding security proofs, bugs in security proofs from Bart Manning. And you can find bugs in the source code. But I have to say, you won't get any money for finding bugs in our JavaScript of our website. So you can still submit bugs until the end of this month to this email address, and you can find everything, all informations about this program on this link here. Thanks, that's it from my side.
Good evening, Vienna! I have the bell, so I have unlimited time. Now, clearly the formatting wasn't done right, and I have a very, very well thought out title, and not just to get a hilarious acronym. Rumor tells that rum sessions are supposed to have funny talks in them. But real humor takes time and preparation. And rum sessions are normally organized ad hoc on the day, and we have very little prep time. You have 24 hours to get your slides ready and put them out there. Submission is on the day of the rum session, and it's reviewed by the chair only. I have a solution. We create an independent body to oversee all the rum sessions. We appoint chairs for all the conferences, much like the program chairs and the general chairs and the organizing chairs. We will have rum session chairs appointed in advance. We open submissions earlier. Everybody can submit when they know they're coming to the conference. We could add peer reviewing for our submissions. Who doesn't want to hear the jokes before they're told? So the main problem is about rum sessions. But it's not all rum sessions. It's mainly cryptologic rum sessions. And I propose we make some sort of association, even an international association. Maybe we could call it the IACR. And we spared no expense and we developed a logo, by which I mean I spent 5 minutes in paint yesterday and did that. So, what will the IACR do for you? It gives the chairs better time to prepare the rum session. Programs will go online before the rum session starts, if one could believe such a thing. It allows you, the speakers, the audience, to prepare your rum session talks, to plan them out. We can have the schedule before the conference even starts. And we're also planning a hostile takeover of the Journal of Cryptology. Sorry, Nigel, I'm gunning for your job now. And we will make rum sessions great again. So, the committee. The president will be this lovely fellow over here, who was elected by a fair and biased coin toss. Vice president, who may or may not be a stormtrooper. We have an animal wrangler for reasons unbeknownst to me, and I've been told that an asymptotically negligible number of animals were hurt in the production of these slides. We have a membership secretary. Please see him if you want to join, and conveniently, he isn't here. And we are setting up steering committees due to Martijn's great contributions at Martijn, the Eurogroup Steering Committee Chair. And to commend Bertram for his excellent job, we're appointing him as the Crypto Rum Session Steering Chair. And eventually, I'll be able to spell his name. Asia Crypt Committee Steering Committee Chair, still open. It could be one of you. Would anybody like to join the committee? I was expecting a more enthusiastic response. Would anybody like to join the committee? There we go, Greg Rose, ladies and gentlemen. Our industrial liaison is Susan Thompson, who's hiding right now. And we got an AV technician from outside. I hear the guy's really good. And also, I would like to close with a very important announcement. I am Satoshi. Thank you, good evening, Vienna. And I believe this ends the first session, and we'll now have a break, yes?
Wait, 1 second. So thank you for the presentation so far. Remember, this is a Trump session. Donald Trump will build a wall around the adversary and will make the adversary pay for it. So there will be a break now for about 30 minutes. Enjoy yourself.
Yes. I mean, it's ruining everything. Because if people, you can't. can't even laugh because you can't hear people around you laughing at that.
Okay. Just put it there.
Felix?
All right, everyone, we'll start in a minute. And if you want to chat, please go over to the next room. Thanks.
Good evening, everybody.
Let me just leave this slide on for a second. So let's start over. This is the schedule of the second session. This is the name. So if you present and you didn't still present, then find out the list here. The schedule of the second session is online now, since 30 minutes, actually.
Yeah, thank you. No, next one.
30 seconds.
30 seconds? Yeah, thank you. Hello again. Can you read it? The only difference, the second letter, that was the fatal error. So we changed it back. And to be serious, here is the round function. It's a spec-like cipher. We hope that it is compact, it is lightweighted, good-looking, and I hope secure. But it's a formula. If you will prove that it's insecure, we'll rename it from after John Nash to Donald Trump. Thank you.
Executive decision and nix this talk.
Sorry?
I'm making the executive decision, you're out.
You are.
Get the fuck off stage.
Okay, I've got an important announcement to make. If you could all just listen up for one moment, please. Thank you. If I could have your attention at the back. No. There's one guy here taking notes in the rump session. He must work for NSA, right? He's shaking his head. FSB, GCHQ. Okay, I guess you're all having a good time at the back there. I want to talk about something very important that involves Donald Trump. I want to talk about the Crypto Forum Research Group. Do any of you recognize this? This is the internet. Okay, it's kind of important. Without this, you don't have Facebook, you don't have WhatsApp, you don't have porn sites, you don't have all the things that cryptographers love to do. There are two organizations called IETF and IRTF who are trying to make this thing work. That's their fundamental objective. And within the IRTF, there's an organization called CFRG, which stands for Crypto Forum Research Group. And that's where there's lots of interesting cryptography going on that's making the internet more secure. Okay, here's the charter of the CFRG. It's a lot of words. It basically says, we're trying to fix the internet. We're trying to make it more secure. And we need your help. So if you're interested in getting involved in CFRG and making the internet stronger and more secure, then come to the meeting, which is happening this Thursday at 1:30 in the floor below here. We've got lots of interesting presentations, and the meeting is open to everybody. So everybody, you don't have to be a member of any organization. You don't have to be from any particular nationality. You can come along and contribute. And you can also ask me more. And it's very important that you come. Otherwise, this happens, okay? If you don't come and help make the internet more secure, the internet is screwed, okay? Thank you very much.
Okay. So how to write secure papers? So you might think our goal is to construct secure crypto primitives. This is not true at all. Of course, to be honest, what we really want is to write secure papers that are secure against attacks from reviewers, right? Yeah? So I made a systematic study of this. And of course, first thing you have to do is to classify your adversaries. So a semi-honest reviewer is one that doesn't read the paper, he just reads the abstract, then flips a fair coin to decide whether to accept the paper. Much worse is a malicious reviewer who constructs a different set of results that's totally different from what's in the paper and claims that because his other set of results is uninteresting, the paper should be rejected. Okay? In between these, we have a covert reviewer who looks, he does look at the paper, constructs a different proof of the main result. And of course, because he likes that proof better, understands it better, he claims that the paper should be rejected because the main result has a trivial proof. So that's the classification. Now we go to the model for security. Of course, we want the best possible security, so we go for universal composition. This model was first studied by Mozart. Universal composer, if ever there was one, he was cool. Of course, what we want is universally composable review security. Here's the definition. So a paper is UC review secure if there's a simulator. So for all venues V, if you feed the simulator, the paper, and the venue, you get a set of reviews that's indistinguishable from the actual reviews you would have gotten if you had submitted the paper to that venue. Okay? That's a very strong demand, of course. I have a theorem that I proved, which says, well, using review security requires an honest majority of reviewers, otherwise it doesn't work. Okay, so now about constructions. This is the next thing, of course. Of course, we think obfuscation solves any problem, right? And I have observed that obfuscation seems to be a very popular method in many papers I've seen. And okay, I'll grant you that obfuscation might confuse a malicious reviewer. It does not work for a semi-honest reviewer because he doesn't read the paper anyway, right? So it doesn't work. Makes no difference. So actually, I have a much better method. You must submit to a venue with a vast majority of good reviewers, such as Journal of Cryptology, of course. How do I know? I'm the editor-in-chief, for crying out loud. We have so far used 212 reviewers who put in a lot of hard work, and I'm here to announce the prize for reviewer of the year. Don't worry, it's not a picture of Donald Trump or anything like this. It is, ta-da, Vincent Ryman, who accepted all, yes, yes. Yeah? Is Vincent here? Is Vincent here? No, no, okay, too bad. But he accepted all 90 invitations to review and still, on average, submitted his reviews 36 days earlier than he was required to do. That's amazing, I think. So, yeah, and so having solved the problem of matching secure papers, thank you, that's what I had.
Hello, everyone. I'm Mei Chen, and this is John Wang with Jian Guo and Lin Song. This talk is brought to you about the Kremlin theory of SHA-3. K-check is the run of SHA-3, and it has 24 runs. Each run has 4 steps. The K is the only nonlinear operation. And 7 known attacks are based on the attack lineage of neuralizer. One runs could check every function. We found that 2 or 3 runs could check every permutation can be also linearized. And we also found the bilinear structure of the K X blocks. Given 2 bits of the output, we can set up one linear equation on the input bit. And this theory table gives 3 bits of the output, we can set up 2 linear equation on the input bit. So this is very useful for the pre-image attack. We also we used the linear structure of the K-check to improve the zero sum distinction. By 2 runs with the same complexity. With our distinguish is practical up to 11 runs, and for the 12 runs it almost practical. The time complexity is 2 to 16.5, and we also improve the pre-image attack on the K-check. We can attack all the variants of the SHA-3. For up to 3 runs, our image attack is practical for 3 runs. Shax 128. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. So recently, with Martin and Chi, we published this paper on the apprint, and we're kind of proud to announce it was accepted to crypto. There's also a concurrent work presenting the same results. So the impact of the paper is like we break those not very important stuff. But we got some feedback that our paper was kind of, you know, spreading some fear about Ntrue, because it's called attacking overstretch Ntrue assumption. And we were asked, why is Ntrue in the title? Why don't you use the DSPR name? Are you just fear-mongering? So we're very sorry for everyone who feel that way. Our intent was very different. We didn't really meant to discredit, we really meant to credit. We think that Ntrue were very pioneers in lattice-based cryptography, and they anticipated many of the theories that we have today. For example, Ntrue scheme kind of inspired FHE, and some people called it the Gentrue scheme. We don't really have interest in discrediting Ntrue. I'm kind of using it in another scheme, please. My conclusion is that Ntrue assumption is quite powerful, both for theory and practice. It has passed the test of time. It's kind of around for 20 years. So we can deem it secure, unless you overstretch it. Thank you.
Hello, Eurocrypt. You guys hear me out there? Woo! Yeah, let's hear it. All right. So I'm here to talk about how we're going to make crypto great again through the real world, and real world crypto in particular. So I have to announce that we're going to be in New York City again, one of the best cities in the world. Thank you, thank you. We'll be at Columbia University, January 4th through 6th. Now, this is not ideal world crypto. This is real world crypto. And we have to deal with all sorts of real annoying issues, like the fact that 7 cryptographers cannot figure out how to get HTTPS working on their website. It's a painful, painful situation. Thank you, thank you. All right, so New York is awesome. There's lots of reasons to come there, one of which is the great tourism opportunities. You can go check out all sorts of great venues. It is open to the public. You don't have to worry about the cold weather. We have a plan. We have a plan for this, okay? It's going. All right, a little more seriously, Real World Crypto is about bringing industry and academia together. We have about 50-50 industry academic talks. We invite people. We also accept submissions, and it'll be open in the fall. It is a very exciting place to be, to hear and to give talks about cryptography. Just to give you a sense of who comes and how many people, I'm not going to count raccoons here. I'm not going to play that card. But you can see the attendance at Eurocrypt and Crypto and the attendance at Real World Crypto. And the reason for this is that we get a lot of industry people to come, okay? Lots of industry people, and they're very excited to hear about the latest in what's happening. Also, I know I'm losing the crowd in the back. Come back. Come back. I'm talking about money now, okay? $10,000 to each of the 2 awards that go out for the Levchin Prize. Max Levchin was very great to donate this money. Last year, the winners were Phil Rogaway and the MeTLS team, not Mozart. Okay, and you can nominate people for this prize, so go to the website. We also have lots of industry engagement in terms of sponsorship, and this is the obligatory asking you to find more sponsors for us, so come tell us if you're interested in sponsoring or know someone who would be. So in summary, let's make cryptography great again, particularly in the real world. Please go nominate for Levchin. Please nominate speakers that you think would be good. Submit talks and help us get sponsors. Thank you very much, and see you in January next year.
All right, again, if you wish to chat, please go to the next room over so that we can hear our speakers.
All right, now we have our first invited talk of the evening. Could we please have a big round of applause for Jens, who bravely volunteered to do this? Ladies and gentlemen, Jens Gord.
Enjoy. Thank you. Okay. So as you can see, this is a fortress, right? We're trying to attack it, and this is how cryptanalysis usually work. So there's a lot of E&Ms, and these kind of things. And that all goes into the scheme somehow. And then there's a sieve mode. So we are doing a sieving. So clearly this is about RSA factorization. I'll quickly jump through and tell you about the attack results, okay? So we have excellent performance here against breaking RSA. So there's a lot of copies because it seems to be easier to batch break RSA. So we built a non-uniform Turing machine. The reason we do that is we do a lot of pre-processing, right? So we develop a circuit that could attack RSA. And as you can see, the complexity of these attacks goes down with time and the number of queries that we make. So one example where this is used is in dentistry. So this is really real-world crypto. So if you want to have dentistry done and you have problems with your teeth, you can use this tool here. You break RSA encryption, you find out the secret mechanisms behind dentistry, and that's how it works out. So we use this camera here to take a photo of the teeth, and then I don't know what the eagle is about. Okay, so here we have the curve again. It's the same curve, as you can see, it still goes down and down and down and down. Just like this presentation here. but there's a difference here, right? Because now we're working in the ideal model, right? There's an ideal T, okay? And there's a realistic T, right? And of course, we're aiming for the ideal T. We want the curve to go up there to the ideal T. And for that, the only thing that can save us at this point and me at this point is to use indistinguishability obfuscation. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to obfuscate the two circuits. So there's the ideal T, there's the realistic T. We obfuscate both of them. Now they're indistinguishable, right? And that will bring the curve up again. Right. So how does indistinguishability obfuscation work, right? I mean, the first thing is you create a branching program. So you can go from one box to the next one, and you have multiple layers of this circuit that you're trying to obfuscate. So for depth 5 circuits, we can do it. We can do it for greater depth as well, depth 6, depth 7. Actually, we can do it for any constant depth circuit. It does, however, get very problematic when we get into logarithmic size circuits. There, the obfuscation mechanism doesn't work. The path is too long because we've been drinking too much as this reception, and we'll go off the chart somewhere. So the question now with this circuit model here is whether it's actually possible to get full security, right? Is that feasible or not, right? And the problem here is that you need to spend at least linear time because you have to go through every single box. You have to obfuscate every single circuit. But we have a technique for this. We write everything in a list. We basically do a brute force attack, right? So we go from, we take let J, go from 0 up to capital N. And we do the same operation every step. So the advantage is that it's a very, very simple algorithm. Anybody could come up with this and write it in this programming language. I realize this is not C or Python, but it's pseudocode, and that's also a respectable programming language for cryptographers to use. So with that in mind, thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, can we thank Jens again? No preparation, hadn't seen a single slide yet. A big round of applause for Jens, ladies and gentlemen. Huh? Yeah. I just said that. So who does that? Okay. Right. This is you? Oh, yeah. Hello, this is a talk about oblivious transfer from any non-trivial elastic noisy channel.
So we know all know oblivious transfer, so I can skip that, or at least most of it, a lot of do. So elastic noisy channel. It's a channel where if the receiver is honest, he could hear this loudly. And if he's malicious, he hears much, much louder because he has a much, much bigger antenna. So then this question, when he has a bigger antenna, can we still have a protocol that's secure even if we want a receiver that speaks very, that the receiver can hear very softly and the dishonest receiver can hear very loudly? Well, there is a very nice result that was shown at, yesterday that shows that in some cases it's possible. And this is a very nice result. And what we've done is we've extended this result to show that it's always possible as long as there's some upper limit on how well he can hear. So this is the nice colorful slide. And sorry for being as loud as Trump.
Hello, everybody. So we are all the new code breakers. OK. So 6 years ago, there was a meeting in Luxembourg about how to do a face for the 80 years of David Kahn. And we did it. And the idea was to have a volume of LNCS, Springer, putting together a lot of papers about that. So at Crypto 2011, I did a call for that. And the result is the following volume about the new code breakers. By the way, if you don't know, an anagram of the new code breakers is the new bracket errors. I am speaking about us. So here is the volume. So maybe you don't understand the cover. And I will explain. Maybe there it's an encrypted form of Mozart. There, maybe it's a stylized raccoon. Why not? And the volume we edit together, I have 73 authors. And in the room here, there are about 8 authors. So it's from the community. The most downloaded paper at the moment is post-quantum cryptography, state of the art. So it's about 2,000 download. So it seems that the subject is very important. And I have a prize for you. One volume down to Springer, but I have only one or to share it. So I need to set a challenge. The question will be the author of the next drawing, and you send me an email to my address there. And the first one, I know there are delays for servers and so on, is the rules. We sent to me. I was thinking to send me an email about the inventor, authors of Bitcoin, Satoshi. Maybe you don't know that there are 6. And I wanted to know one from you, but I think that is difficult. I am not joking. And so the question is, send me an email about the author of that drawing, about David Kahn, and the prize is the volume from Springer is finished. Thank you very much.
It might not work because. Does anyone want to participate in a little quiz show? No?
All right. We have a quiz and we need participants. Do we have any volunteers, ladies and gentlemen? Anybody? Come on up, come on up. Come on. We need more. We need one more person. We have one more. Oh, we can do, come on. We still need one person. There we go, ladies and gentlemen. We have our contestants. I need to remind you, no drinks in the seating area.
That's definitely behind.
All right. I will now hand you over to our quiz master for the evening, ladies and gentlemen. Is there a prize for the quiz?
Yes, there's a prize, if I can find it. Anyways. Let's see if I can do this. All right. So the first game is this one. Name these acronyms. I'm going to give you acronyms from the crypto. Like, there's a ton of acronyms, a ton. And now I'm going to test your knowledge. Okay, so the first acronym is B-A-K-E. For 1 point. Wait. First, I should have asked the participants' names to present themselves.
Hi, I'm Christine.
I'm Rémi.
I'm Florian.
I'm Geoffroy. Nice to meet you.
Yes, I was standing there. So number two, B-A. I hope you all agree. I hope at least half plus one agree. It is Byzantine Agreement. So now I'm going to go faster. TRE, quickly. TRE. It has something to do with quickness. Time. Time release encryption. I'm sorry, no points for this round.
Damn it.
So the next two appeared today. So, or in this session, so the sessions that have been so far. Actually, today, the first one is TT. It's been in a talk today. Traders.
Trade or tracing.
And now we'll switch to the second game. It's called the periodic table and crypto. So this one has both an acronym. Oh, yes. So actually these ones are both a cryptographic primitive and a chemical element. Can you name both of them?
Yes. No.
Which one?
The first one is Fe.
Iron. And?
And
that's all. Functional encryption.
Yes, that is correct. Iron and functional encryption. Let's see. So, the next one is GE.
Tellurium.
Graded encoding.
Yes, that is correct. The first one is green. And that is correct again. Germanium. And then one last one. And the final one. AM.
Americium.
Damn, you know your first. And that is correct, Arthur Merlin. And that ends the quiz. Well done, all participants. Thank you for listening. I will find the prize.
Get the mic.
All right. So, ladies, gentlemen, and cryptographers, I'm going to tell you about the USB sticks that you all received when you were at the reception. So, of course, the USB sticks do have the proceedings on them, as is expected, and as no one ever looks and reads. But there's also a bootable partition. There's also an OS on your USB sticks. And getting those two things to work at the same time was a huge pain in the butt, okay? So I hope you all appreciate it. Please do look at the proceedings for once. It took a lot of work to get that to work on Mac and Linux and Windows. And definitely special thanks to Björn and Patrick for helping. Okay, so first thing, because we actually wanted this extra partition, we kind of had to sacrifice for security a little bit so that it actually auto-mounts and everything works nicely. In other words, we went for appeal because appeal trumps soundness. Yes. All right, so the point of the sticks and the point of the distribution, the OS, is for you guys to play with it. And important, if you like it, it's not production quality, okay? It's not like as secure as it could be. And so if you'd like it and you want to use it, make your own, okay? It's not that difficult. So what's this OS, all right? Tails. Well, Tails. Okay, a little more seriously. It's an OS, and it provides, so the goal of this distribution, it's a Linux distribution, and the goal is to provide easy to use, strong privacy and anonymity tools, okay? So it's Linux, but don't worry, no command prompt needed for all the fun stuff. Everything is pre-configured and equipped with nice setup wizards for you guys to try. It's all, you know, clicky, pointy kind of stuff. And yeah, so what are some of the features of this OS? Well, okay, it leaves no trace. So what do we mean here? When you boot this thing, it mounts the USB stick in read-only mode. It doesn't touch the local hard drive on the computer, okay? And afterwards, if it's working correctly, it wipes memory so that there's no cold boot attacks and things like that, all right? It also has an option if you actually want to store data, then there's a wizard that lets you set up an encrypted partition. And for those of you who have tried to do that, it's not always that easy, but in this case, it's super easy, all right? It's like just two clicks. And so, right, so it does full disk, it does disk encryption for that partition. It also has Tor browser, all pre-configured, ready to go, PGP integrated with the email client. If you want to generate keys, it's stored on the persistent partition, so also encrypted. There's an app for doing integrity checks, so you can compute all your favorite hash functions of files, password managing, Bitcoin wallet. This one's pretty cool. I didn't know about this. Document metadata anonymizer. So in your Word files or PDF files, these programs leave a lot of metadata lying around, which you don't actually see in the document. So these things anonymize that. Collaborative document editing, lots of other stuff. So basically, try it. It's recommended by some pretty serious people who care about privacy, not recommended by the NSA, and by Mozart. So yeah.
So welcome the second guest for the PowerPoint Karaoke. Let me explain in some words what a PowerPoint Karaoke is. So our two candidates, Martijn and Sam II, are given slides, six slides, which are randomly taken from presentations from past ISCR conferences from the last 5 years. A big thank you to the anonymous contributors of these slides. I hope it's okay to steal their slides for this show. I hand over to Martijn. He has six slides to present.
Thank you. So we start with this slide, and I can't see it from here, so I'm going to join you because I noticed that the audio over here is shit anyway. So if I yell while I'm sort of standing in the middle of you, you might be able to hear it. So the first idea that we have here is that we have controllable, malleable, soft software encryption. Oh, this is very convenient. There's a teddy bear and a robot and a little devil. And the little devil is actually the good guy, and the robot is also good. But the bear is cheating on the robot. So any questions so far?
No, thank you.
No questions here. Questions here.
Are these guys serious?
Are they serious? Yes, they are serious. So we will continue with transformation. So you've all seen the Transformers movies. So they were going to come up next. And one of the things that will happen in the Transformer movies, if you pay attention, is that there is a client and a cloud and a key. And that leads then eventually to lower bounding the probability of good transcripts, which is a major challenge. And if you want to know more about this, I really urge you to come to the session on indifferentiability tomorrow, where Chan Ren will give an excellent talk and he will explain these sort of techniques in much more detail. And then you will see this probably. Yeah, so that's it.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Wei Chang. I'm coming from Yen Ster Yong. I'm going to describe an improved reduction from BDD to USDB. It's a driver with a Shibai and Damian delay. BDD is a variant of CVP with promising that the distance or target vector and the lattice is within some bound distance. And USDB is solving SVP problem with promising that the first there's a gap between the first two minimum. In 2009, Lubacevsky and Misencio present the first reduction from BDD to USDP. In their reduction, they reduced BDD 1 over 2 gamma to USDP gamma. And then later on, Mingjie Liu improved this reduction to reduce from a small alpha. And then more recently, in 2015, this alpha is getting even smaller. Finally, in this year, we found a way to decrease alpha to square 2 gamma. To be more clear, you can see the graph here. The up is dotted line, the pink dotted line is our result. And it's going to be appear in ICAP 2016. To start from Lubacevsky Misencio 2009, they reduce the BDD 1 over 2 gamma to USDP gamma with Canon embedding. And we improve this reduction combined with a cost of specification on lattice to make it even closer. Now BDD and USDP, there's only a square 2 room between BDD and USDP. So we also know that there's a reverse reduction from USDP gamma to BDD 1 over gamma. So we can improve. What we can improve is that there's a USDP 1 over a gamma to BDD 1 over square 2 gamma. So our conjecture is that with some parameter, BDD and USDP is computationally identical. And this parameter, we also conjecture is that BDD 1 over square 2 gamma is equal to USDP gamma. So we need your help to complete this this work to combine these two problems together. Thank you. Thank you very much.
All right. Listen, people. This talk is about solving a problem that you have, so you better pay attention. And because it's an important problem, esteemed professor Jens Groth and kind of okay superficial guy me will role play it for you. So let's get started. Jens, what do you do?
Well, I'm a cryptographer.
That's super interesting. Like, please, Jens, do tell me more.
Sure. I solve hard mathematical problems. Okay, so you see the problem, right? So we put together this demonstration to show how to get through and explain what it is that you do without boring people too much. Okay, so let's try again. I study group theory.
Wow, that is so interesting. I'm super interested in that as well. So Jens, in your research, what is a group?
Well, every group has an identity.
Yeah, I can totally relate to that. But Jens, do you think that there is no friction whatsoever in a group?
Well, there's always a negative element.
Yeah, indeed. Like Rachel, and actually Rachel and Chad, like whenever kind of they are together, they're always trash talking everybody else at the brunch meeting. Right, so every Sunday we meet for brunch and they're just like nagging everybody, complaining about everybody. But they're still kind of part of the group, aren't they, Jens?
Sure, if you combine two elements, they stay in the group.
Wow, this is so insightful, Jens. Indeed, I can see how this result generalizes, because when Chad and Peter got married, you know, Chad and Peter from our brunch group, they would still come to brunch every Sunday. There was no problem. But you know what is a problem in groups? Is Anna. Because Anna moved to the other end of the town and she doesn't attend the group meetings anymore. Do you have anything to say about that, Jens?
Well, we call it groups where members commute a billion.
That is so helpful. I mean, realistically, at this point, your conversation partner would think like that's awfully specific, right? So we have group theory for commuting groups. But hey, it's academia. They study all kinds of nitty-gritty details, right? So that's fine. So Jens, that really was helpful and that relates a lot to my life. But like, so what is your focus? What do you care about most in your research?
Well, I focus on studying secret powers in groups.
Yeah, I can totally relate to that. Because Ashley, right, whenever we make lunch plans, we're always ending up going to the restaurant she wants. Every single time. So Jens, can you tell me anything about these members with secret powers?
Well, it's hard to say anything about secret powers as evidenced by Diffie and Hellman.
Okay. That is really helpful that this is a really hard problem. Thanks, kind of, that science clarifies that Clark Kent distinguishing him as Superman is a hard problem. So, but anything else kind of you focus? I mean, like now I'm really hooked on your research and I want to know so much more.
Well, right now I'm very interested in groups with hidden order.
Yeah, did you know that Mozart was a Freemason? All right. So Jens, what is the hottest result on groups in your research?
oh, there was a cool thing I discovered this morning. You can construct a general purpose indistinguishability obfuscation for all polynomial sized circuits from constant degree graded decoded schemes in a plane model, assuming the existence of some exponentially secure pseudo-random generated computer by a constant degree arithmetic circuit or equivalent in NC zero and the sub exponential hardness of the learning with errors problem.
Hi, another commercial. I'm not going to trump the previous one. This is a book that appeared recently. Let me see how this goes. So here's a book. If I convince you, you can buy it downstairs at the Springer table at a reduced rate. Table of contents. It has technical sections where I go into great detail for some systems, but it's not a handbook in that I talk about everything. A special feature is many historical chapters. Cryptography is unique in science in having such a universal appeal, secrecy, communication. It has a rich history, and you find that in many examples that have not appeared elsewhere in this text. There's a lot of illustrations. I'll show you two technical ones, which you probably know, the AES flow, and this is a pseudo-random generator, physical hardware generator that I really like and is one of the very few that are certified to be true. Here is something that will look like crypto to you. It's not to Egyptologists. In general, they can read hieroglyphs. But this is hieroglyphic writing that was encrypted at the time. So then the Egyptian scribes and today Egyptian cryptologists still fight over the hidden meaning of these symbols. This is a picture I took at Bletchley Park a while ago. Colossus is often called the first computer. The book was published in December last year, and this is the statistics I got in March. I was dumbfounded. 7,700 downloads in just 3 months is rather incredible. My suspicion is that these are not 7,700 downloads, but that when you download the whole book, 25 chapters, then you're counted as 25 downloads. But still, this is a very satisfactory number. And my very last slide is one of the explanations for this. The book is made for students in that for many protocols, I give in great detail the foundations in order for the instructor to be able to say, well, go and look it up in the book, because that's my experience. If you tell the students, go look it up in the literature, it's good for the bright graduate students, but not for your everyday student. And a long discussion with Springer led to a totally amazing price, $30, and you can chase any raccoon away with this book.
Okay, so hi everyone. So this is a joint work with Hotek, our chair, and my fellow PhD students, Florian and Rafael, who are right there. Say hi, guys. So this paper will appear at Crypto this year. So the problem that we focus on is the fact that when homomorphically evaluating a function f, the output ciphertext leaks information about this function. This is what we want to avoid. In fact, our goal is circuit privacy, which means that we want to hide the function f. This problem has already been studied in previous works, but our work is the first one to simultaneously rely just on standard LWE, achieve polynomial hardness, multi-hop evaluation, and circuit privacy. And it is almost for free because we basically take the GSW encryption scheme with successive improvements and we add a small noise. So the difference is that we have a new approach, which means we analyze the noise distribution carefully instead of just giving a bound on its norm. So this is a glimpse at our core lemma. So we take the error in the output ciphertext, we sum a polynomial noise, and we claim that this is indistinguishable from a fresh Gaussian term. This means that V is hidden and F is hidden, and I would like to stress that we have two sources of randomness. One is from the randomized G minus one algorithm, and the other one is from the additive noise Y. So this is what I had for you. The paper is on ePrint if you want to have a look. Thank you for your attention and good night, everyone.
So this is the end of our RAM session this year. Come on, guys. So thanks to my co-chair, lovely co-chair, please applause. Even more applause to our technician. He's sitting there very humbly in the corner. This is Felix Sawyer from the Ruhr-Uni Bochum team, and he is a lover of raccoons, apparently. So are the two of us. I do thank all the speakers, in particular our performance today of the karaoke. Enjoy your time. Have a good night.